Very important announcements to share with you briefly. Today, I would like you to know the golf tournament again has been rescheduled to June 20th. We have accommodated social distancing. Space is limited, so if you're interested, please sign up. Also, I want to let those know that have been working with Josh on some of our youth and children activities that right now we're looking at possible postponements, rearrangements of a few activities, including the youth mission trip, Vacation Bible School, and Grow Day Camp. We are thoughtfully considering options for these. As you'll see in a moment, that does conflict with a very important date given to us by the Bishop and the Cabinet. And so if you're a leader or worker in one of those areas, feel free to reach out to Josh as discussions are underway how we may best minister to our youth and children. And then also, the Bishop has sent out dates and guidelines for reopening for worship. Our projected first Sunday back in the sanctuaries is June 28th. And in the meantime, Pastor Brent will be assembling a task force, and each church will do the same, that is intended to help prepare the sanctuary and the congregants for worship in a safe manner. So that will begin June 28th. And we will be preparing diligently so that worship is safe and enjoyable when we come back together. And so I also want to mention to you then that we will continue to have online worship each Sunday until we're back together. And even after we're back together, we will be sharing video of our worship services together. And then also we are looking possibly at a joint service that would be a drive-in service. A joint service between Toccoa First and St. James, somewhere here in Toccoa. Not sure we're going to do that, but if we do, we'll certainly let you know. So this morning, let us go to the Lord together in prayer. And Holy God, the hour seems dark, but the promises of God are always bright. We ask and pray, give us grace, give us peace, and give us patience. Remind us that you're with us in the storm. We ask you, Lord, to help those who are sick, strengthen them, and help them persevere, help them to heal. Give grace to the children and youth that are at home in an unusual circumstance and in a lot more time than they're used to. We ask you to bless families through this experience. We ask you, Lord, to remind us to be thankful, for we have so much to be grateful for. And so, Lord, we look to the day when we will give thanks when we are back together. And we must give thanks because you do just as you have promised, and you'll see us through this time. And so we join our hearts today, and in one heart and one mind we pray. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Bring your tithe and bring your shame. Bring your guilt and bring your pain. Don't you know that's not your name? You will always be much more to me. Every day I wrestle with the voices keep telling me I'm not right. But that's alright, 'cause I hear a voice and it calls me redeemed. When Bring your doubts and bring your fears. Bring your hurt and bring your tears. There'll be no condemnation here. You are holy, righteous, and redeemed. Every time I fall, there'll be those who will call me a mistake. Well, that's okay, 'cause I hear a voice and he calls me redeemed. When others say I'll never be enough, greater is the one living inside of me than he who is living in the world, in the world, in the world. Greater is the one living inside of me than he who is living in the world.
Amen. Amen. children and their children. May his favor be upon you and the thousand generations, and your family and their children and their children and their children. May his presence go before you and behind you and beside you.
Bye. Our scripture today comes from 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 1 through 10. So put away all malice and all deceit and hypocrisy and envy and all slander. Like newborn infants, long for the pure spiritual milk, that by it you may grow up into salvation, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good. As you come to him, a living stone rejected by men, but in the sight of God, chosen and precious, you yourselves, like living stones, are being built up as a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For it stands in Scripture, "Behold, I am laying in Zion a stone, a cornerstone chosen and precious, and whoever believes in him will not be put to shame. So the honor is for you who believe, but for those who do not believe, the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone and a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense. They stumble because they disobey the word as they were destined to do. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Do you know the difference between dogs and cats during this pandemic? Dogs are happy because their best friends have finally quit their jobs in order to stay home and play with them all day long. Cats are happy because their servants are finally working for them all the time. Listen, I love my cat and my two dogs, and if we've learned anything about my younger dog, Ringo, over these past 2 months, it's that that dog loves playing with tennis balls. He absolutely can't get enough of them. He simply never gets tired of having you throw a tennis ball across the yard for him. It's his favorite thing in the world. And you say, oh, he likes to play fetch. No, not fetch. Because you see, fetch implies that when you throw the ball, the dog gets it and brings it back to you and either like lets you take it out of his mouth or drops it for you so that you can throw it again. And my dog does not do that. When you reach to get the ball from him, he backs his head away, his mouth away, to ensure that you can't get it. Now, if any of you want to come and train my dog how to play fetch, you feel free to do that. Because my dog literally wants to have his ball and chase it too, if you know what I mean. But as much as he loves playing, having this tennis ball in his mouth, if you ignore him long enough and you don't take the ball from him, he will eventually drop it on the ground and then nuzzle the ball up to the side of your foot as a way of saying that, okay, come on, it's time to throw the ball again. But my point is, this dog loves tennis balls more than anything. He craves playing with tennis balls. And the good news is that we humans have the ability to satisfy that dog's deepest desires. I bring this up because, believe it or not, Peter says something similar about our relationship with God in verses 2 and 3. Remember last week, Peter was talking about how we are born again if we're in Christ. Peter continues with this image of new birth in today's scripture. Look at verses 2 and 3. Like newborn infants, long for the pure spiritual milk, that by it you may grow up into salvation, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good. In Greek, the expression spiritual milk literally means the milk of the Word. And that Word, of course, is God's Word, the Bible. So Peter is saying that the main thing that's required for us Christians to survive and thrive in our faith is hearing, reading, studying, meditating upon God's Word. Now make no mistake, elsewhere in the Bible, the apostles talk about how some Christians need milk instead of solid food or meat, that those Christians who need milk are spiritually immature, but that's not Peter's point here. No, Peter is saying that all of us Christians, whether we're new to the faith or whether we've been Christians for a long time, every single one of us needs the milk of God's Word to nourish us and sustain us. And we should be like newborn babies in craving it, in demanding it, and in refusing to be satisfied with anything other than this pure spiritual milk until we get it. In one of his books, Pastor Tim Keller wrote about his experience of being diagnosed with cancer. Up to that point in his life, and this was after he was already a successful pastor, but up to that point in his life, he confesses in the book that his prayer life was not where it should have been. But his wife convinced him that the two of them need to pray together every night before they go to sleep. They need to get down on their knees beside the bed and pray. And this was something that was new for the two of them. I mean, they prayed on their own, but they had never prayed together. And like Keller said, he had never prayed. He wasn't praying the way he knew he ought to have. Well, some of you know this from personal experience, but I mean, nothing kickstarts a vibrant prayer life like being diagnosed with cancer or some other life-threatening illness. And I know that even right now during this pandemic, a lot of us are probably praying more than we normally do, perhaps out of fear. But whatever it is, God is using it to help us pray more. And that's a good thing. Tim's wife, Kathy, insisted that the two of them pray together every night before bed. And she told him this: imagine you were diagnosed with such a lethal condition that the doctor told you that you would die within hours unless you took a particular medicine, a pill, every night before going to sleep. Imagine that you were told that you could never miss it or you would die. Would you forget? Would you not get around to it some nights? No. It would be so crucial that you wouldn't forget, that you would never miss. Well, Tim, if we don't pray together to God, we're not going to make it because of all that we're facing. I'm certainly not. We have to pray. We can't just let it slip our minds. I believe in today's scripture, Peter is telling us something similar about God's Word. Spiritually speaking, like a life-saving medicine, we will die spiritually if we don't take it. Like a newborn baby, we will starve to death without it. Now, I'm not interested in pitting God's Word against prayer, you know, and asking, well, which one is more important? If you're a Christian, you can't have one without the other. We speak to God through prayer, but the number one way that God speaks to us, the number one way that we listen to God is through this book, through reading it and meditating upon it and just listening for God to speak to us. The Holy Spirit does something supernatural when we come to God in God's Word, when we open ourselves up to God's Word. The Holy Spirit has a way of applying these words to all the different circumstances and problems and challenges and situations that we're facing in our lives. God speaks to us through this book, whether by reading it or studying it ourselves, or through Bible study, or through sermons, or through singing the Bible-based words of Christian hymns and Christian songs. We encounter Jesus through this book. The Lord guides us through this book. The Lord teaches us through this book. The Lord corrects us through this book. He comforts us, encourages us, strengthens us, convicts us, gives us direction through this book. Are we treating it like this is life-saving medicine, like it's what we need for our very survival, or aren't we? In Revelation chapter 2, Jesus speaks a word to the church at Ephesus. First of all, he commends them for all the hard work that they're doing, all their faithful work that they've done. But in verse 4, he says, "But I have this against you, that you have abandoned the love you had at first." In other words, the love that they had for Jesus when they were first born again. I can relate. I became a Christian when I was 14, and the Lord really got hold of me. I responded to an altar call. I prayed a prayer of repentance and confession, asking Jesus to come into my heart, and I experienced the Holy Spirit in a powerful way. It was real to me. My faith was real to me. I was excited. I got baptized. I told friends and acquaintances at school what happened to me. I was witnessing to people. I was on fire for Jesus. I wanted everyone to know about Christ. I had a zeal for the Lord. I was in love with the Lord. And within a couple of years, I had saved my money, and I had purchased what was a very expensive book at the time. I purchased something called the NIV Study Bible. It was a wonderful resource for understanding God's Word. And it's been updated since then, and I'm sure it's still a wonderful resource. But there are plenty of good study Bibles out there now. But I think the NIV Study Bible was the first of its kind. Anyway, I loved it. I devoured it. So much so that before I graduated from high school, I had worn this Bible out. The cover had fallen off, pages were missing and torn and folded up, and it was a well-worn Bible. It was marked up. I had written in the margins and underlined and highlighted. So just before I went off to college, I replaced this well-worn NIV Study Bible with a new copy, a nicer copy, you know, one that was made, the cover was leather, and it had my name engraved in it. I took it with me when I went off to college at Georgia Tech, prepared to turn that campus upside down with the gospel of Jesus Christ. And well, I never needed to buy a replacement copy for that study Bible. Sadly, that Bible made it through my 4 years of college unscathed because I got busy with other things, distracted by school, by the pressure to fit in, the pressure to succeed in a worldly way, the pressure to find a good job, the pressure eventually to be a good boyfriend and husband and later father. Before long, I realized I wasn't feeding on the pure spiritual milk of God's Word anymore. And this lasted for years. And at a low point in my life, the Lord showed me that I was not taking His Word seriously. And it was killing me spiritually. But thank God He gave me the grace to change. And I thought I would give you some evidence of the change. Some of you have seen this. This is my workaday Bible. I've had this for 7 years. I've taken it to Kenya twice. I've taken it on mission trips. It's been around the world. It is my ESV study Bible. The cover, the front cover, the back cover have fallen off a couple of times. I've taped it up. Literally, pages were falling out. A friend of mine carefully taped them back in. You know, pages are all folded up, and it's a mess. Of course, it's marked up. But look how beautiful this is. I mean, like, this is my sword. I have fought some great spiritual battles with this Bible, and it is precious to me. And I suspect one day I'll send it off to get a new cover put on it and to have some of the pages repaired. But I like that Bible, and it reminds me. It reminds me of the great change by God's grace, nothing that I've done, by God's grace, the great change that the Lord has worked in my life. So what accounts for that change? Well, let's look for a moment at the language in today's scripture. Peter says, long for the pure spiritual milk. Taste that the Lord is good. You cannot fake longing for something. You cannot fake desiring something. Either you long for it or you don't. You can't fake when something tastes good to you. Either it tastes good or it doesn't. It's not something that you can fake. You see, during that season in my life when I was far away from God's Word, I thought of reading the Bible and studying it as something that I had to force myself to do by sheer willpower. It was my duty as a Christian. I mean, I knew I was supposed to be reading the Bible, but it was duty and nothing more. Needless to say, Peter is not talking about something that you have to force yourself to do. He isn't talking about duty. He isn't talking about willpower. He's talking about, get this, he's talking about something that brings us pleasure, something that makes us deeply happy, something that satisfies our soul's deepest longings. And when I flip through the Bible, I see these promises of pleasure, of happiness, of satisfaction everywhere. Let me give you a few examples. You find them throughout the book of Psalms and elsewhere. But let me just read some of these promises, some of these powerful words. In God's presence, there is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. Psalm 16:11. O taste and see that the Lord is good. Peter is quoting that. O taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who takes refuge in him. Psalm 34:8. Delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Psalm 37:4. As a deer pants for flowing streams, so pants my soul for you, O God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. Psalm 42, 1 and 2. O God, you are my God. Earnestly I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh faints for you, as in a dry and weary land where there is no water. Psalm 63, 1. Or how about Jesus' words? The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field, which a man found and covered up. Then in his joy, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. In his joy, Jesus says, Matthew 13, 44. Or Paul's words, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. Paul means to say there that there's always reasons for us to find joy in Jesus. Philippians 4:4. Brothers and sisters, this language of joy and lasting happiness and satisfaction of your deepest longings. It's available to us, and it's free, and it's the pure spiritual milk that you find right here in this book. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. When King David wrote those words, he wasn't saying, now I want you to think it through. I want you to use your intellect. I want you to reason it through. I want you to apply these principles of logic until it all makes sense. No, he says, experience it for yourself. And once you experience the kind of pleasure that comes from the pure spiritual milk of God's word, you won't settle for lesser pleasures. Okay, but hold on. Does this pure spiritual milk of God's word really satisfy us in the middle of a pandemic? Just yesterday, I saw some scary headlines related to Governor Kemp's decision to open businesses back up in Georgia. I mean, listen to some of these. These were national headlines. New model shows how deadly lifting Georgia's lockdown may be. Georgia, Florida, and Mississippi are veering toward a terrifyingly premature end to their COVID-19 lockdowns, according to a new pandemic analysis. One article even cited epidemiologists and computer scientists at MIT and Harvard. I'm not saying that these worst case scenarios are going to come to pass. I pray that they don't. I hope that they don't. I pray that we'll be okay. And I pray that Governor Kemp's decision is a wise one. I don't know. I'm not pretending to know. But these headlines sound scary. You've got to admit. Well, speaking of being scared, I think of the Apostle Peter. He was with his fellow disciples on a fishing boat on the Sea of Galilee one night during the midst of a terrifying storm, a violent storm. He thought he was going to drown. Listen to the way that Matthew describes it. And if you have your Bibles, and you should, you can turn to Matthew chapter 14, beginning with verse 22. I'm going to read just a couple of verses here, though, beginning with verse 24. Matthew says the following, "The boat by this time was a long way from the land, beaten by the waves, for the wind was against them. And in the fourth watch of the night, he, Jesus, came to them, walking on the sea. But when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified and said, 'It is a ghost.' And they cried out in fear." Okay, already I am pretty sure that very few of us are experiencing that kind of fear right now. Maybe you remember what happens next. Peter summons the courage to ask Jesus to command him to walk out on the water toward him. And Jesus agrees. "Come," he says. And Peter takes a few brave steps. And Jesus, please notice, doesn't calm the storm before Peter starts walking out to him. No, the storm is still raging. And before long, Peter notices the wind and the waves. And what happens? He becomes afraid. And he starts to sink. And if he sinks, he's going to drown. And he cries out, "Jesus, Lord, save me." And Jesus, of course, is right there, ready to pull him up and bring him to the safety of the boat. And then Jesus miraculously calms the wind and brings peace. Listen, when we read these headlines about the deadly effects of the virus, or we read headlines about the devastating effects on our economy from the virus and the pandemic and the response, it's very possible that we become like Peter. He was afraid, and beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me." But when we long for and receive the pure spiritual milk of God's word, we hear the next verse. Jesus immediately reached out his hand and took hold of him, saying to him, "O you of little faith, why did you doubt?" And suddenly, Jesus isn't just talking to Peter 2,000 years ago. Jesus is talking to you and me in the midst of this or any other crisis in which we find ourselves. He's saying, "Oh, you of little faith, why did you doubt? Didn't you know I was right here the whole time? Didn't you know I never left you? I never was going to leave you. Didn't you know that I always stood ready to pull you up? I know how scary and out of control everything appears to be right now, but I'm not scared. I'm not out of control. I'm not going to let you drown." That kind of pure spiritual milk from God's word tastes good. And that's exactly what I need to sustain me during a time like this. How about you? Listen, there's a verse here, verse 1 of chapter 2. When I read these verses without thinking through them, I sometimes think, well, that's not very helpful. Peter says, "So put away all malice and all deceit and hypocrisy and envy and all slander." And I want to say, okay, well, if I knew how to do that, I would. But you see, I'm a sinner, and I just find that I do these things, and I don't have much control over them. Listen, that's not the way you're supposed to read them. Because he says, put these sins away. And then, beginning in verse 2, when he talks about the pure spiritual milk of the word, that is supposed to help us. If we begin to desire the pure milk of the word and receive it for ourselves, that is what is supposed to help us put these bad things away. So, for example, put away all malice. Well, malice, that's like hatred. You know, we feel anger and hatred and resentment, you know, when things aren't going our way. But when we receive the pure spiritual milk of the word, we're told, for instance, that God is working all things for our good, that all things are working out in our best interest, right? And so that helps us with malice. And then deceit. Well, that's being dishonest, lying. Why do we deceive other people? Because we're afraid that they're going to find out the truth about us, and we don't want them to know the truth about us, right? So we deceive them. But hold on. What exactly is the truth about us? Well, when we nourish ourselves on the pure spiritual milk of the word, we remember that who we are, well, we are sinners saved by God's grace alone. Isn't it a miracle what God has done for us? We are now God's people, Peter says in this scripture. He has made us. Before we didn't know mercy, but God has graciously, generously shown us his mercy. That's who we are now. So we don't have to deceive others. And the same with hypocrisy. Hypocrisy is when you're pretending to be someone that you're not. But we don't have to pretend. Do we know who we are? We're God's beloved children. When we find our nourishment in this pure spiritual milk of the word, we remember how beloved we are as God's sons and daughters. He loves us as much as he loves his own son, Jesus. So we don't have to be hypocrites. We are honest about who we are. And envy. I want something that someone else has. Are you kidding me? You've got everything. in comparison to what you and I have in Christ Jesus, everything else, Paul says, is utter garbage. So we don't need anything that anyone else has. We've got it all. And when we nourish ourselves on the pure spiritual milk of the Word, that's what the Lord tells us. And slander, that's when you put someone else down in order to make yourself look better. You look better at someone else's expense. Well, good grief. When you nourish yourselves on the pure spiritual milk of the Word, you read here that you're a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for God's own possession. It's like God owns us. We are His possession. He loves us so much. He loves us so much, He paid an infinite price by sending His Son to die on the cross in order to make us His own. So we couldn't look any better than we already look because we know what God has done in order to make us His children. This happens when we find the satisfaction for our deepest desires in this pure spiritual milk of the Word. I invite you to look for your soul's deepest satisfaction right here. Amen. Almighty God, enable us to fall in love with your Word. Let us feel thirst and hunger for your Word, and when we turn to it, satisfy those deep desires that we have. Enable us to be transformed by it. Enable us to find the guidance that we need, the strength, the peace, whatever it is that you need to tell us, speak to us through your Word when we turn to it. Enable us to desire the pure spiritual milk that you so graciously and generously give us. There is an endless supply of it, Lord, and we need it every day. So enable us to turn to it and to turn to you every day. In Jesus' name, amen. So this past week, many of you from our church came by and you picked up these cups with wafers on top. And I hope you have one. Some of you might have already gone ahead and celebrated Holy Communion with the liturgy that I handed out. If so, that's okay. But if you still have your cup and wafer, I'm going to invite you to participate with me in a service of Holy Communion, and you can follow along at home and serve yourself. It's a little tricky if you've never opened one of these before. There's a little clear plastic tab right here that you pull off, and that's where the wafer is. And then there's a foil tab underneath that you pull off to get to the grape juice. It's white grape juice. And I think it's white so that if you spill it on yourself, you're not going to get a bad stain. So anyway, that's how you use these. Remember, I have already consecrated the wafers and the juice that we've handed out over this past week. So it is perfectly within keeping with our doctrine on Holy Communion for you to participate at home using these. Okay? This is extending the Lord's table. But I'm going to lead us now in the liturgy for the Lord's Supper. On the night in which Jesus gave himself up for us, he took the bread, gave thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This cup is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Christ Jesus, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes again in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet table. Through your Holy Spirit and your Holy Church, through your Son Jesus, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. And all of God's children said, Amen. The body of Christ given for you. The blood of Christ given for you. Amen.
Hear the voice of love that's calling. There's a chair that waits for you, and a friend who understands everything you're going through. But you keep standing at a distance in the shadows of your shame. But there's a light of hope that's shining. Won't you come and take your place? And bring it all to the table. It's nothing he ain't seen before. All your sin, all your sorrow and your sadness, there's a Savior and he calls. Bring it all to the table. He can see the weight you carry, the fears that hold your. Through the cross you've been forgiven, you're accepted as you are. So bring it all to the table. It's nothing he ain't seen before. For all your trials, all your worries and your burdens, there's a Savior and he calls. Bring it all to the table. Bring it all. You can bring it Savior and he calls. Bring it on.